What's up, Marco? What's up, brother? Let me tag some people, man. Listening to Anthony Evans, How He Loves Us, y'all. How He Loves Us. One of my favorites. Say he is jealous for me. What's up, Instagram? Just getting this Facebook set up, fellas. Ladies and gentlemen. Hope everybody's having a wonderful day. This button's just so little. Just so little. Yeah. What's up, boy? This is Anthony Evans. This is actually Tony Evans' son. He's a gospel singer, Anthony Evans. One of my favorite songs by him called How He Loves. How God Loves Us. So tonight we're going to talk about how you love others. How I see you, my sister. Go way back. All right, y'all, let's get this thing going. What's up, sis? Hey, what's going on, Lynn? What's going on, cuz? I see y'all. Yeah, we listen to Anthony Evans, the song is called How He Loves Us. How God Loves Us. Hey, what's going on, Rick? What's up, Nuke? What's up, Dub? Let's open up in prayer, y'all. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this appointed time, Father. Thank you for being in the presence of us, Father. Thank you for each and every person under the sound of my voice, Father. Thank you for my brothers and sisters, Father, for your children, Father. Thank you for this word tonight, Father. Thank you for placing this on my heart, Father. Father, may there be a blessing to this word that we're about to hear, Father. May there be an application afterwards of this word, Father. May it be beneficial to each and every person on this line, Father. May it be beneficial to the people in their lives, Father, to the children, to the young people, to the kids in their lives, Father. May they be a light in this world, Father. May they light be a help and a blessing to all that's around them, Father. Thank you again for this day, Father. Thank you for sending your son to die for our sins, Father. I just want to thank you, Father. Thank you for giving us the energy, Father, and the know-how, Father, the understanding to make it through these days, Father, through this pandemic, Father. Bless those families who are struggling during this pandemic, Father. Bless them. Bless those who have lost loved ones, Father. Bless them. Comfort them, Father. Increase their hope. Increase their faith, Father. Let them see the light at the end of the tunnel, Father. Let them see your face, Father. Let them fall and feel the comfort of your arms, of your hands in their life, Father. Father, I just want to pray for each and every person, Father. May it be an adherence to their hearts and their minds, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 What's going on, Derek Anderson? What's up, Chris? Yeah, we were listening to Anthony Evans today, y'all. Like I said, this is Tony Evans' son. Song is called How He Loves. How He Loves Us, Father. How our Father loves us. And one of the reasons... that I chose this song actually was because today's lesson we wanted to talk about children. I almost used Whitney Houston, I Believe the Children Are the Future song, but I thought that this song was a little bit more appropriate because it's really not necessarily about how God loves us as much as this lesson is about how we love the youth, the children in our life. And you know, God does so much for us that he sent his only begotten son for our sins. So the question tonight is like, what are we willing to do and what are we willing to compromise and sacrifice for our children, right? For our children. I think about this pandemic and I think about the opportunity that we have to pour into our children during this time, right? We have a huge opportunity. We're spending time with our kids like never before. And I'm like, man, what's the word for Tuesday? I'm like, this is, you know, I think about myself. I think about the opportunity that each and every one of you all have that has children. And even if you don't have children, you think about this lesson tonight. There's a population of you all who have God children. You have nieces and nephews that you need to be pouring into, because one thing we talk about pouring into people is that, like before I talked about the Dead Sea, you know, every time something comes to you, we want to make sure that it leaves us. It comes in this hand and it leaves this hand, right? So we're not a cul-de-sac. So everything that's knowledge, that's blessings, anything we're blessed with, we should share. So tonight I wanted to talk about us sharing something more valuable than money, more valuable than gold, right? It's sharing the word of God with our young people in this world, right? Sharing the word of God with our children, right? We have this huge, like I said, we have this huge opportunity to pour into them during this time. So I just want to make sure that maybe, you know, at least one person maybe jump started to do something different with their children. So that's what I thought about. I thought about during this pandemic, as I started doing these Tuesday night lessons, another thing that God put on my spirit was to spend some quality time with my children. So one of the things I started doing this pandemic was, you know, I just started reading the Bible with my 12-year-old son every day, right? We would start reading it every night, and we started with Proverbs and went through Genesis every day, just one chapter. And what I see from that, I see how just reading that time we reading together and us sharing it, the word of God together every night, how that's actually moved over and transferred up into other areas of his life, right? He's trying to play golf now. He's doing different things. So I think that I know this word of God breeds confidence. It breeds a huge value into the lives of young people, particularly children, right? Think about, like I said, one of my favorite quotes from Frederick Douglass, I'm sure you guys know it by now, is that it's easier to build strong children than it is to repair broken men. So right now, I think it's critical that we get them at an early age while the steel is still cold, right? Before it get hot, right? Before they get into and create these habits for themselves. So anyway, I just wanted to talk about that tonight, about children and pouring into and how what God says about pouring into our children, what God says about teaching our children, what God says about disciplining our children, and also what God says about our rewards if we do that properly. Because if we do that properly, you know, we'll be rewarded, you know, with their future. So, like I said, that song we listened to was Anthony Evans, How He Loves Us. I wanted to talk about how we love our children. And one thing I was thinking about when I was thinking about this lesson plan is during this particular pandemic, and how I'm partial to men's ministries to a certain degree. I do the men's ministry every Wednesday at St. John's. I've been doing it on Zoom since the pandemic. I do that every Wednesday night. I'm with the men. And we do more of a book study type of deal. So, you know, just the importance of the father. You know what I mean? Think about God being the father and the father. And one thing I think about is how back in the 90s doing my research, talks about how in the 60s and 70s, there really was a shift in the culture, right? There was a shift in the culture in reference to the word of God, right? There was a shift more so away from theology into more so into sociology, right? More, less so about God and more so about man, less so about God's word and more so about man's wants and desires, right? And this kind of shift kind of started in the 60s and 70s. And I, you know, we could probably, parallel it or reconcile it with, along with everything else that happened during, I guess not necessarily segregation, but when we were open, things were opened up, you know, and what actually happened when segregation was over, right? When things were over, when you think about what happened back in the 60s and 70s, what started happening is the father started leaving the home. And another thing I thought about is our father started leaving the home. So the absence of the Father God and the absence of the American father all started to shift in this country roughly about 50 years ago, right? And you got to think about the importance of a father in his children's life. And I think that's definitely one of the main reasons that this country and our culture is in the state as it is in right now is because the lack of the father in the house, right? And we think about all these sisters and these single parent moms who's raising these daughters. One thing that has been consistent is that the woman has consistently been in the house. So the woman has consistently been giving the women what they need, right? Because the woman has been there. They say out of all the single parent households, males represent about 20% of the 100% of black single parent households, 20% of them are male. So roughly, single women are in roughly 80% of the households, period. You know, in addition to all the two-party households. So you think about that. It's important for the father to be there, because the father is actually, he's implored to bring the children up in the ways of the Lord. That's the father's responsibility. That's why in the Bible it always talks about father, son. That's the man's responsibility. He's supposed to be the discipline. He's supposed to discipline them. He's there to encourage them. He's there to comfort them. He's there to instruct them. But if the man is not in the household, that means the kids are missing discipline, which is critical. They're possibly missing the father's encouragement and the father's. And one thing I've learned over the last couple of years, how important is the father's affirmation, particularly for the males in the household, right? Father's affirmation. The male needs the father to say, well done, son. You know, when he get in his teens, 18 and 20, say, son, you're doing a good job. And so if the father's not there, there's lots of males missing that. So it's very important that, you know, the word of God is not necessarily replacing the physical father, but the word of God is in the household, because so many people are missing out on their fatherly instruction. So even if your father isn't in the house, the word of God should be in your house. So you sisters should take it upon yourself to make sure your kids are grounded, because we love our kids so much. We buying them Jordans. We getting them all these nice things. They got Xbox 4s and 5s and PlayStations. They doing all that. We buying everything to appease these kids. But the one thing that I can say we're probably failing, we've all been guilty of it, is making sure our kids are grounded, really have a sound understanding in the word of God. So anyway, I just want to talk about that tonight, just kind of preface it with a little context, why it's so important, particularly, you know, we think about we're going through this pandemic right now. You know, imagine 30, 40, 50 years from now, what our kids are going to have to endure. Our kids are going to have to endure so much, right? I don't, you know, in my 48 years of here, I haven't seen the world necessarily getting better as a whole. I've seen situations getting better, but not as a whole. I think the world is dying more and more and more so. So I think it's safe to assume that it's not going to be any better when they get older. So in saying that, we must understand that it's very, very critical that we armor our kids up with this word of God so that they protected out in this wicked wilderness that we are in, right? So anyway, a couple, just some statistics, right? So I'm thinking in our culture, in the black culture, and I don't know who's out there, but I did some research on a couple cultures. And I just wanted to see a little bit about the single parent household, right? Since it's so imperative that, like I said, the word of God is in these households. Think about this. It says between 2014 and 2018, there was a study done. It says out of all the single parent, the single parents in black families, that would represent about 75% of the black families were single parent households. I said 75%. 75% of black families are single parents households. I'm like, wow. So that means out of four people, three of those people are from single parent households, right? 75% in the black family, 58% of single parents in the Hispanic households, 58% in the Hispanic population, right? 37% single parents in the white households. 21% single parents in the Asian households. You heard that? We 75% in the black families are single parents. 58% in Hispanic families are single. 37% of single parents in white families. 21% single parents in Asian families. It said in 2019, of 130 countries, the U.S. had the highest rate of single parent households, period, in the world. Out of 130 countries, we had, you know, and I think one of the reasons we have so much freedom that we have the freedom to really hang ourselves and to work outside of God's word, right? So our secular culture, you think about it. I said it's assaulting our children are being assaulted through media, through social media. You know, we have to try to learn to control what's at their fingertips, because they're literally being assaulted. You think about it. Your child, I have a 12-year-old son. My 12-year-old son, him in his room, himself, with a TV, with cable, with a computer, with no restrictions, you know, that's like allowing your son, your children to take a stroll in the red light district, right? You know, you take them to Amsterdam and just let them walk down the red light district. They can run into all kinds of stuff. So that's why it's imperative that we have passcodes and we have things like that on our kids' technologies, because it's imperative. Imperative. It says, you think about it too, it's like the families have been, you know, back in the 50s and 60s, how the families were more parent-centered. we were trying to cater to the parents and do the things the parents wanted us to do. And we were, you know, we were being disciplined. We got that belt put on us. And now you think about society, it's like about appeasing the children. Like the children are running the household. We see it in grocery stores, but you got to imagine what's happening in people's houses. Your studies also show that children who are obedient are also more happy than children that are disobedient. So we must, like I say, instill these values in our kids so they, you know, have a better chance of not really experience any level of depression, right? It said children must have a healthy amount of fear and respect for their parents. It said study shows that kids with the highest score the highest on the social and emotional well-being are the children who occasionally get spanked. Said the kids who actually parents don't spare the rod, they score higher on the emotional and social well-being different tests. We must discipline our children. Also, you think about disciplining our kids, and we have people that feel both ways. And, hey, to each his own. But it said when we do discipline our children, we must discipline our children judiciously. You know, we must also, when we say judiciously, we have to make sure there's a process, right? We must understand that we must also saturate our kids with love. So we can't just discipline them and not exemplify love. We can't just punish them. We have to actually saturate them with love, let them know we care about them. And this happens in so, and this is why a lot of kids become rebellious, is because there's discipline, but there's not encouragement, there's not comfort, there's not love, that's not being displayed. You think about that. It says this helps build up stress, and you think about what's going on in this stressful society and what's going on with these parents, we're dealing with these kids, and just like we talked about last week, we have to make sure our kids are operating on a definitive truth, right? We have to make sure that the kids are established with this definitive truth, because we talked about last week about being unified in truth and in purpose. But we have to make sure that our kids have a definitive truth of that same truth, which is the Bible, which is the word of God. Because what happens is, just like we talked about last week, we're operating on our own. Everybody has their own truth, all these different people, and there's no unity. The same thing can happen in a household if our kids are not taught the word of God properly, right? Because now they're operating on their own truth, and your one child operating on her truth, another child is doing this, another child is doing this. This is why we must make sure that we're unified as a household. We kind of talked about it last week, but this week is about being unified as a household to the point that our children's future is going to be bright because of the things that we're instilling in our children. You got to think about it. And then I talk about addressing the kids early. You say we got to attack, well, not really attack, but we have to address this situation early while the iron is cold, while they're young, before they form these bad habits, you know, before they get in their ways, before they get caught up in playing these video games for, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 hours. You think about it, we have to prepare our kids, because just like Satan, you think about it, Satan tempted Adam and Eve, Satan tempted Job, Satan tempted who? Jesus. Think about Jesus in the wilderness and Satan rolled up on him. He tempt you, so you know Satan's going to tempt your kids. So just as it's important for you guys to be armored up in the word of God, we have to make sure our kids are armored up in the word of God. And the thing about it, we can't give what we don't have. We cannot give what we don't have. So in order for us to prepare our kids for the world, we must prepare ourselves for the world so that we can have something to pass on to our kids and pass on to our grandkids and on to our great-grandkids. So now I want to talk a little bit about some scripture, right? Get into some scripture about teaching our children. And one of the things I wrote here says, we must be proactive with raising and teaching our children, because to be reactive would cost us too much. And that's in anything in life. It's a lot cheaper to be proactive than reactive. It's going to cost you a lot more to be reactive. So if we don't train our kids now and teach them the proper ways to move, to navigate through life, to try to have the proper disposition, the proper relationship, intimate relationship with God, keep him first in their life, in so many cases later in life, there's going to be some hurt, some pain, because of the lack of knowledge that we've actually transferred to our kids, right? Lack of understanding. You know, I think about my life. I think about how I grew up in East St. Louis originally, and my grandmother was a constant presence in the church. But when we moved to Houston, you know, we didn't go to church. My parents didn't make me go to church. We didn't go to. We only went to church for funerals or weddings or something, but we didn't go to church. So I didn't start really going to church until I was in my 20s. And then it took me another 20 years to really, really get it in me.
But I'm like, what would happen if I'd have been going to church as a child? How many of these mistakes could I have missed? Could have not actually brought upon myself, right? And you got to think about it, even with the children, and you think about teaching our children. And one thing I want to mention, you think about the commandment. It says, honor your father and your mother. Honor your father and mother. That's so important to God that we have this kind of rapport with our children. Our children respect us. That it's the first actual commandment with a promise. It said, then your days will be long. Your days can go well, right? So that's what that's actually the commandment. So Proverbs 16:16, want to get into some scripture, says, and we're talking about teaching children. So these scriptures are going to be about teaching our children. And this is what the Bible says. Proverbs 16:16 says that having wisdom and understanding is better than having silver and gold. And that's just like saying, you know, I could give my son $100,000 today. My 23-year-old son, I give him $100,000 a day. And he's a little wise, you know, so he might not be a good example. But in most cases, you know, you can give a person $10,000 a day. You know, they won't have it within the next, you know, say month or so. I give them 2 months. They won't have the 10,000, right? But the thing, so I think it says that, it says that wisdom and understanding is better than having silver and gold. So you think about what's more valuable than money, what's more valuable than silver and gold is the word of God. Because if you give that word of God to somebody, they can have it with them forever. And they can also transfer it to other people, pass it on to their kids or their kids' kids. So that word of God is more valuable than any amount of money or gold, because it's not going to last. But if you have that word of God, and that word of God is passed through generation to generation, generations will be blessed. Generations will be blessed. You know, you think about, because you can give, like I said, you can give people money, but they won't have it. But you give them wisdom, you give them knowledge, understanding, particularly of God's word and God's wisdom, they will have it all the time. They will have it the rest of their life. So we're thinking about teaching these children. And I remember once when I was in high school, I was dating a girl and I was talking to this, her father. I'll never forget this. He told me this story, and this story has to be 30 years ago, right? So 30 years ago, this man told me about his process of raising his children. I said, you know what? I think that's accurate. I think that's pretty good. He said, there's three seasons to raising children. He said, the first season is a dictatorship. He said, the first season is maybe from the time of birth to basically 9 or 10 years old. It's pretty much a dictatorship. I'm dictating. I'm teaching my kids. I'm cultivating in them. You know, they have a very little say-so. So he says, I'm actually pouring into my kids. I'm setting a tone for the rest of their life in those first 10 years of their life. I'm setting a tone because there's three seasons, he was saying. So the first season is the dictatorship. I'm pouring into them. So this is the season where we should be pouring in the word of God, pouring in discipline, structure, organization, different things in those first 10 years. Then he said the next stage was like a mutual agreement stage. He said this mutual agreement stage may be from the age of 11, 12, roughly to about 15 to 16 years old. He said there's a mutual agreement stage where, you know, he makes some decisions, I make some decisions, and we come together and make some sound decisions and choices for my son or my daughter. He said, but after 15 to 16, if I've done my job properly at 16 years old or so, that person should really be almost self-sufficient if I've done my job properly. He said, at 16, 17 years old, if I dictated what I need to dictate in the first 10 years and had this mutual agreement with them in these next, you know, 3 or 4 years or so, by the time they're 15 and 16 years old, they should be on autopilot. They should be able to pretty much take care of themselves and take care of their business. Maybe not financially, but they have the capacity to do it. The capacity. And with that being said, I wanted to read this scripture, Psalm 78:1-8. And like I said, tonight we're talking about grooming our kids. Psalm 78:1-8, it reads like this. It says, listen, O my people, and this is from David, right? Listen, O my people, to my instruction. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old. He said, I will tell you of the history, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. So a father was telling them, spending time talking to them. And our fathers have told us, we will not conceal them from our children. Said, we will not conceal our history from our children. And we must not conceal our history, right? We have to make sure, not only, like I said, we're not just giving them money, preparing them for college and giving them material things and making, buying them nice cars and all that. We must give them that word of God. That's the most valuable thing we could actually pass along to our children is the word of God, because it's going to take care of them. And if done proper, they'll play out to their life. It'll take care of their kids, and that's the same word is going to, it's been taking care of people for thousands of years. So the same word of God can take care of all of our lineage of children and grandchildren and things like that. It says, we will not conceal them from their children, but tell them to the generations to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wondrous work that he has done. So I say, I'm telling the generations to come. I want to be here so I can sit my grandchildren down on my knee and explain to them and talk to them about the word of God and the importance of seeking God first and his righteousness in their lives. It says, first, he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel. So this is what they were saying they should be telling the generations behind them, which he commanded our fathers that they should teach them to their children. So he said, teach them your commandments that the generations to come might even, the generation to come might know even the children yet to be born. It said, even the children that's not born, you need to spread this message. You know, you think about the Great Commission, which God told us we should go out and spread the gospel throughout all the countries and all the continents all over the world. But like I said, there was some assumptions made that you were going to at least start out spreading the gospel in your household. In your household, it says that they should teach their generations, that they should teach them to their children, that the generation to come might know even that the children yet to be born, even the children yet to be born, that they may arise and tell them to their children that they should put their confidence in God. I'll repeat, read that again. It says that they may arise and tell them to their children that they should put their confidence in God. So how many of us at this point has told our kids to put their confidence in God? We know our kids, my kids have confidence in me, you know, and their kids have confidence in you and you. But have we told God, hey, you need to put your confidence in God? If even if I'm not here, he needs to serve something higher than just serving us as parents. It says that they should put their confidence in God and not forget the work of God, but keep his commandments and not be like their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation. So, yeah. So he said, tell them to keep those commandments and not be like the previous people that we know. Right. Some people who don't keep the commandments. I thought about this. I say 2 Timothy 3:16 said all scripture is bread and is useful for teaching. Teaching children, rebuking children, correcting children, and training in righteousness. So this is what God's left his word here, this blueprint, this manuscript, this Bible, this basic instructions before leaving earth. It says all scripture, this is 2 Timothy 3:16, says all scripture is breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, y'all. This is what we should be using, this God's word, as a tool to benefit and to pour it into our children. Just pour into the youth, period. Because, like I said, we see what's going on now. So I can only imagine what's ahead. And they have to have on, keep on their armor, as we must keep on our armor every day. 1 Corinthians 11:3 says, but I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ. And the head of a wife is her husband. And the head of Christ is God. Did y'all hear that? Said that, understand that the head of every man should be following Christ. And when he say man, he's not just meaning male species, but even women. But particularly here, he's saying the male in the house should be following Christ and the wife should be following the husband. And Christ is following God. And we think about even right now, just a kind of side note, we think about the relationships today, particularly in parental relationships and why there are so many single households. And why there's so many, like I say, single people, particularly in our culture, say 80% of households in our culture are single parents, is that I think that the man is not following the word of God. And there's so many. And like I say, I have a special place in my heart for these men's ministry because I know how important the man is to the household and how important it is for the man to be following God so that his wife can follow him. You know, that's another side note. That's a whole another lesson, but it's imperative. And I believe that's one of the reasons that the households are in the position they are because the men are no longer following God, right? And the women refuse to follow the man who is leading them nowhere, right? He said, where you going? Where you going? If you're not, who you following? You want me to follow you, but where you taking me, right? And so many people out here, you know, they have these audacious dreams and things, but God needs to be at the forefront of it in everything you do, right? In everything. Proverbs 1:8 says, hear, my son, your father's instruction and forsake not your mother's teaching. right? Psalms 32:8 says, I will instruct you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and my eye upon you. I mean, you're supposed to teach your kids and train them and counsel them and watch them, mentor them. It's like an apprenticeship, right? It's an adult apprenticeship while your kids are in your house, all these different things that we should be teaching them. And then the thing about it is we can't be hypocritical about our teaching, because it's one thing to tell our kids to do something. It's another thing for our kids to see us doing the same thing and then emulating that, right? Because there's a population of people say, you know, do what I say, not what I do. Man, that does not work. If we haven't figured that out by now, that does not work. People are going to do what they see. So if you want to show some change, you want your kids to make their bed up every day and wash the dishes, you make sure you make your bed up every day and wash the dishes. You do those things because behavior is more often emulated by what they see, not necessarily by what we hear. That's why it's imperative that as we are lights in the world, we're supposed to be giving this light so people can see us, so people can change their life and want to evolve as a person based on how they seen us evolve and based on the blessings they see in our lives and based on the peace they see in our life and based on the joy they see in our lives. That's what people are drawn to, what they see. And so are our kids, by example. Exactly. They're drawn by example. That's, we are physical learners by our eyeballs. Matter of fact, that's why I say it's very imperative that we watch what's on our kids' computers, on our kids' laptops. Because what I know for a fact, and a lot of people may or may not agree with, but is that whatever you ingest with your eyes, whatever you ingest with your ears, whatever you ingest with your mouth is coming out. You know what I mean? It's going to come out. It's inside. So that's why you got to be careful. You know, just like making sure our kids not watching certain things, we shouldn't even watch certain things. You know what I mean? Because, you know, just like watching all this stuff with the pandemic, and sometimes I'm on social media, and I think the thing with George Floyd and all these, man, it wears me out. I feel my spirit, like my pastor Juanita Rasmussen say, I feel my spirit spiraling down from just watching something. I'm like, man, I don't need that on my spirit today. So a lot of the time, I don't even really watch TV. You know what I mean? I don't watch TV. I've been doing that for years because most of the programs are no good, right? They're just programming you to get your money. But anyway, so like I say, it's very important that we mentor these kids. So I want to read Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy, you think about Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy was written in Moses, right? Moses was talking to Joshua. He was giving them some instructions before they was going over to the promised land. And there's a couple situations in the Bible when I think about Jesus. I think about Jesus and how he mentored his children, which were like the disciples, and what he did for them during those 3 years. I think about Naomi and Ruth, and how, you know, Naomi basically became a mentor and she kind of schooled Ruth, and Ruth didn't want to leave her. But most important, and then I think about Moses and what Moses did for Joshua and how he prepared him. So in this Deuteronomy, I'm going to read a couple of scriptures in Deuteronomy. And this is Moses, when he found out he wasn't making it into the promised land, he was preparing Joshua to take over leadership. And so just like we should be preparing our children to take over leadership one day, we're preparing our sons to be fathers of heads of household. We preparing our daughters. We may be preparing our daughters to be heads of households. Either way, we need to prepare them to be heads of household because they just may be. But this is Moses, you know, just kind of mentoring and training and teaching, correcting Joshua, right? So Deuteronomy 6:1-3. This is Moses talking to Joshua. It says, now this is the commandment, the statutes and the rules that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you, that you do them in the land in which you are going over. So it was going over to the land of milk and honey, Canaan, to possess it, that you may fear the Lord your God, you and your sons' sons. So they said generation after generation after generation, you need to pass these things down. He said, first of all, make sure you fear the Lord, you and your sons' sons. You pass that down. You make sure that word gets to your sons' sons. By keeping all his statutes and commandments, which I command you, all the days of your life, and that your days may be long. He said, you keep these, your days may be long. Hear therefore, O Israel, and be careful to do them, that it may go well with you, and that you may multiply greatly as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you in the land flowing of milk and honey. So this is Moses talking to Joshua. He's like, look, make sure your sons and your son's sons, and he's talking to the people that y'all pass this on. It's very imperative that your days may be long by passing this on in their days. Your days may be long. So Deuteronomy 6:6-9 read, and these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk to them when you sit in your house. Listen to this, y'all said, you shall talk to them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. That's all in Deuteronomy 6:6-9, right? You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be on the frontlets between your eyes. They shall be on the forefront of your brain. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. He's talking about these commandments and these laws and these rules. He said, you need to be saturated in it. You know what I mean? He said, you need to, like Joshua 1:8, he said, and it's wild because actually he was talking to Joshua, but then in Joshua 1:8 says, be careful to obey the laws of this book. He said, meditate on the word day and night and be careful to obey the laws in the Bible, in the book. Then you will be prosperous and you will be successful. But he said, meditate day and night. Now I'm thinking about this. Moses told him to put that on the forefront of your brain. So keep that on the forefront of your thoughts. Very imperative, that word of God. And so we must train our kids to keep that word of God on the forefront of their thoughts. You know, when they get away from us, when they get out in public, when they go to school, if they homeschooling now, they going to school during this pandemic, regardless of where they're going, we must teach them God's law. So it's going to help them and help their children and their children and their children. So it's imperative that, you know, like I said, we can't give something that we don't have. So if we're not filled up with the word of God, how can we pass that on to our kids? So we must make it a priority for us to fill up on the word of God. And then we must also, like I said, it's imperative for us to fill up on the word of God. And then when we fill up on the word of God, teach those things to our kids, right? It says 1 Timothy 5:4 says, but if a widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show godliness to their own household and to make some return to their parents. For this is pleasing in the sight of God. And make some return to their parents. So it says, but if a widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show godliness to their own household and to make some return to their parents. For this is pleasing in the sight of God. That's 1 Timothy 5:4. And he said he got to keep the first things first. So take care of your household and then take care of your people. These are the things that we should be cultivating into our kids. Psalms 127:3-5 says, behold, children are the heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb, a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the children of one's youth. Blessed is a man who fills his quiver with them. He shall not be put to shame when he speaks to his enemies at the gate. So it says, behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. They are fruit of the womb, a reward. They are a reward from God. And he said, they're like arrows in the hand of a warrior. It says, like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the children in one's youth. And really what that means is that when children are young, we have the opportunity to build, to prepare them for their godly purpose so that they can hit their target, so they can accomplish the things they're supposed to accomplish in life. But in us making them like an arrow in this particular scripture means us actually equipping them to fulfill their purpose. That's really what that's about. Us equipping them to fulfill their purpose, y'all. And then also Titus 2:4, it says, and so train the young women to love their husbands and their children. I just thought that was cute. I just wanted to throw that in there because that's important. Women teaching these young women how to treat a man, how to love a man, and fathers teaching your sons how to love a woman and treat a woman. Because all this is going to be imperative, and it's going to be all going to be impactful on our grandchildren as well as our kids. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he grows old, he will not depart from it, y'all. Y'all heard that? Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go. And even when he grows old, he will not depart from it. It's going to always be on his heart, that word of God. So then I want to talk a little bit about just disciplining children. And when we think about discipline, you have to think about disciplining children as an act of discipling children or teaching children. So when you think about discipline, and like I said, the base word for disciple is discipline. But when you think about disciplining your children, you think about, like I said, really preparing your children, discipling to them, preparing them to be their best version of themselves, and actually building discipline within your children. It says punishment is not the centerpiece of discipline. You think about it. Leadership is at the centerpiece of discipline, not punishment. Leadership. When we discipline our children, it should come out as leadership. You know, it's going to be painful at the time, but the thing about it is, if they're watching our actions and our actions reconcile with what we are telling them to do, that's leadership. That's why it's important to understand that they may not do what you say, but they're going to do what they see. So the things you expose them to, husband and wives, if they're in a loving relationship, the things they're exemplifying around their kids, very important, very important. Ephesians 6:4 says, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. Proverbs 29:15 says, the rod and the reproof give wisdom. The rod, the belt and reproof gives wisdom. Said, but a child left to himself brings shame to his mother. Y'all hear that? That's important right now. With all these kids being babysat by the TV and the Xbox and the PlayStation, that's basically leaving them alone, right? It says, Proverbs 29:15 says, a rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself brings shame to his mother. It says, like, eventually he's going to bring some shame because he didn't have any guidance. It said, later in life, he's probably going to bring some shame to his mother and father because of the lack of guidance. Like Hosea 4:6 say, my people shall perish for lack of knowledge. So if we don't make sure that we attain the knowledge so that we can give the knowledge to our kids, they're going to perish, y'all. They're going to perish. So if you really, really, really love your kids, you know, don't work overtime and give them Jordans and give them all these material things. Work overtime and study the word of God and give them that word of God that you are now feeding on. You're getting your nutrition from, right? Very important. Proverbs 23:13-14 says, do not withhold discipline from a child. If you strike him with a rod, he will not die. If you strike him with the rod, you will save his soul from Sheol or from the grave. You will save his soul with that discipline, because eventually that discipline turns to a level of respect and it goes on. And then it becomes autopilot. He don't want none of that, right? Proverbs 29:17 says, discipline your son and he will give you rest. He will give you delight in your heart. It's the same thing. He said, discipline him and you will have rest. You know what I mean? Eventually, you know, when you get older, when he get older, you won't have to worry about him. Because some people, you know, you think about like God's word. We talk about planting seeds, and we plant seeds in the springtime and in the fall. We harvest, we eat, we plant seeds and we eat, we plant seeds and we eat. We're thinking about it right now in our kids' lives. We are planting seeds. We are planting seeds in our kids' lives while they're in our household. We don't reap the harvest until they get grown out of our household and we see what they become. So it's important that we plant the proper seeds with the proper nutrients, with the proper sustenance, which is the word of God. It's not just about all these material things we're providing for our children, people. It's not about all that, right? It says 1 Timothy 5:8 says, but if anyone does not provide for his relatives and especially for members of his household, which would be his children, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. So if you had the opportunity to provide for people, particularly, he said, for your relatives, especially your household, he said, if you're not taking care of your business, if you're not providing for them, and when he say providing here, I don't think necessarily just a financial provision, but also the word of God. You got to prepare your kids in all ways. You have to allow them and put that armor on them every day. And that real armor is the word of God. You can give them all the money in the world. It's not going to necessarily protect them out there in the wilderness in this wild world. So it says, but if anyone does not provide for his relatives and especially for members of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. He said, provide, right? And that's provide that word of God, y'all, that riches. Like I said, the word of God is worth way more than any amount of gold and silver, because that's going to dissipate. You know, that's, you can't take that with you. But that word, when applied to your life, will change your life. It will save your life. It will save the life of the people around you. Because just like I say, Matthew 5:14, say, you the light of the world, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. He said, when you put that light on the lampstand, it's going to give light to everybody in the house. And when he said, I'm not going to put a basket over you to cover you up, but I'm going to put your light on a lampstand so you can get light to everybody in the house. That's what that means, is that when people see your light, you're going to bless them. People, as I tell my guys all the time, I say, man, everybody is a role model. Everybody's a role model. Everybody's a role model because everybody is being watched. Somebody's watching each and every one of us. And if they watch us long enough and hard enough, we should bless their lives. Because they watch me long enough, they're going to be like, man, I'm going to pick that up and add that to my repertoire. Right? I'm going to add that because they watch us. We all role models, y'all. If they watch us, we have the opportunity to bless our haters. We have the opportunity to bless our haters. You think about Luke, 23:43, when Jesus was on the cross, when Jesus was going down to Calvary, y'all, and he had the two criminals going with him. You know, they had just met him like 10, 15 minutes or an hour or so before he went to the cross. But what I'm saying is that they watched Jesus. And when Jesus got on that cross, y'all, from them watching Jesus, because our kids watching us, them watching Jesus for just a short period of time. They didn't watch him like the 3 years like the disciples did, right? But these particular criminals who were hung, one on the right, one on the left of Jesus, they watched him. And one said, you know what? After a while, he was like, man, you know what? I want whatever he on, whatever he got going, I want to be a part of it. He said, Father, he said, remember me when you get into your kingdom, when you get into paradise. And then, you know what Jesus said? Jesus said, truly, today you will be with me in paradise. So my whole point in that whole little story is that Jesus walked, changed this man's life. What Jesus did in that short period of time, because at first the man was blaspheming him and mocking him and talking bad about Jesus. Then eventually he said to the other crook, he said, hey man, I don't know about you. We guilty, but this man is innocent. This man is innocent. I got to change your heart. And he was like, hey, Jesus, remember me when you get into your kingdom. And Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. All behind Jesus walked, and he had a cross on his back. He was about to go get killed. He was about to do all these things. But whatever behavior he exemplified in that short period of time caused the one man to say life to be changed and saved. And so we have the opportunity, because we've in people's lives for tens and twenties of years, we're in each other's lives. But whose life are we impacting? Are we impacting the life of our children? And so tonight's lesson is about impacting the life of our children. And if we teach our children properly, and if we discipline our children properly, there's going to be some rewards, because we plant these seeds now, and when our kids get grown, we reap the rewards of the harvest of what we did when they were children. All the parents who were like this and all that, I'm sure if they think back long enough, in most cases, because there's an outliers and exceptions to every rule, but in most cases, they probably can think about, yeah, you know, I know why I went wrong. Right? I know I went wrong. So we want to make sure we, like you say, over-deliver anything. We want to over-deliver. We don't want to burn our kids out, but we want to get to the point where we make sure our kids have a sound understanding of the word of God, right? Because, like I say, if we teach them and we discipline them right, there's going to be a harvest in the end. And so it says discipline, like I say, is an act of discipling the children, right? We must remember that too. Discipline is an act of discipling children, right? We are creating the people that they need to be, just like Jesus was discipling his disciples all the time, teaching them, showing them, correcting them, reproving them, encouraging them, whatever it may be. That's what we do with our correction with God's word. So in some of the parental rewards, we're going to talk a little bit about that before we get out of here. We're going on about 50 minutes. It says, Proverbs 10:1 says, a wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish son brings grief to his mother. It said a wise son. And in lots of cases, the reason that that son is wise is because of something that was instilled in him in a young age. You know, period. So it's imperative that we breathe life into our children. We give them more than an opportunity. We give them the best opportunity. Like I said, particularly knowing what we know now, with what's going on with this pandemic, man, we just got to keep them prayed up, and we have to stay prayed up, and we have to stay in the word of God, and we have to teach them the word of God so that they can teach the word of God to their children, y'all. Proverbs 23:4 say, a father of righteous children has great joy. A man who fathers a wise son rejoices in him. Can you imagine reaping that harvest 20, 30 years from now when your children are grown and you like, man, I'm just really proud. Not that I did a good job, but look at God did with my son, right? Man, that would be great, but we must make sure they have the infrastructure of the word of God in their life. Proverbs 27 says, the righteous lead blameless lives. Blessed are the children of them. Proverbs 17:6 says, children's children are the crown to the aged, and the parents are the pride of the children. So the children's children, say your grandchildren, right? Say they are the crown of the aged, of us when we get older. It's going to be our grandchildren. And if we want our grandchildren to really, really have a future, we got to make sure that our children have a future, right? We have to prepare our children so that our children can have something to pass on to our grandchildren, y'all. Very important. Think about this pandemic. I think that the children is the most neglected population of people right now. Right now, they're home being babysit by video games with parents going to work and so much. But these children, like even Whitney Houston said, children are our future. We must pour into our children, y'all. 3 John, the last scripture says, 3 John 1:4 says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in truth, y'all. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in truth. No greater joy. You talked about that truth, and that truth is God's word. No greater joy than to know that your children is walking in God's word. Your children is not on sand, that they're on a solid rock. No greater joy, y'all, than that. Like I said, in order for us to give, we can't give something that we don't have. And in order for us to give the word of God to our loved ones, to our children, to our nieces and nephews, to our godchildren, to the youth of today in America, we must be filled up on the word. Like I said, we cannot give what we don't have, y'all. We cannot give. And the most valuable thing that you can give your kids is wisdom. Give your kids some wisdom. Spend some time with your kids. Like Jesus spent 3 years with those disciples from the age 30 to 33. Moses spent 40 years in the wilderness with those, teaching them and training them. I don't know how long Ruth and Naomi was together, but Ruth and Naomi hung out. So much wisdom in the Bible, y'all. And like I said, I would recommend, if you want to start, I think Proverbs is the book of wisdom. That's what me and my son started. And like I said, that's just something we started during this pandemic, and I recommend it for each and every one of y'all. If you just read one little chapter a day and just kind of expound on it, get a learning, teaching Bible that has like commentary below the text, below the scripture, that'll be helpful. But you just got to, we have to get it going. We have to do better, man. We have to, like I said, pour into our children, y'all. We're going to get out of here. Our children are walking the truth. I hear you, Pauline. Our children walking the truth is the ultimate joy. God's word is the guidance and encouragement. Amen. 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 Y'all, this song is called Not Too Late to Dream by Sherry Jones Moffitt. M-O-F-F-E-T-T. Not Too Late to Dream. Say that $1 million idea, y'all. We all have these ideas. Maybe just what we need. Thank y'all. Thank y'all for joining me. Thank y'all for joining me, man. It's been a pleasure. Appreciate you, Dana. I see you, Coop. Come a long way, my brother. A long way. That brother know my story, man. We come a long way, man. God is good, man. He saved my life. And he'll save yours. Allow him to save your children's life. He wants to. Like I said, we can't give something that we don't have. So we got to go get it. Y'all have to be about it, y'all. Y'all have to be about God's word. All the rest is material stuff. This stuff going to be here. You know what I'm saying? Until it's not, right? Appreciate you, Kenneth. Appreciate you, April. I see you. Appreciate you, Pauline. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Tracy. I see you, Mark DC in the house. I see you, boy. That's what's up. Much love. Much love, y'all. Much love. We're going to pray us out of here. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Father. Thank you for this word, Father. Thank you for this audience, Father. These people seeking wisdom, Father, looking for your word, looking to be righteous, Father, looking to be more righteous, Father, looking to increase their sanctification, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the family and friends tonight, Father. Bless them, Father. Cover them, Father. Increase their finances, Father. Cleanse them of all inequity, Father. Cleanse them of all malice, Father. Cleanse their hearts, Father. Cleanse their minds, Father. Soften their hearts. Make them fertile, Father, so that your word may take root. May take root and multiply, Father. Reap benefits 30 and 60 and 100-fold, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this message, Father. Thank you for sending the lamb, Father. Thank you for sending your living word, Father. Thank you for this blueprint, Father, to live in a prosperous, abundant life, Father. Thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I see ya. I see you, Sonya. Jay Mike. I see you, Noob. What's up, James? Amen. Amen. Amen, y'all. Love y'all. Love y'all. Love you, brother. See you, Marco. Till next week, y'all. Till next week. It's been good.